Hi, welcome back to Strangers in the Oil. This is Dolly, and I've got Sister Irene, and we're taking up where she just left off. She was living in a horrible non-marriage with a man that refused to basically have anything to do with her. He did not want to be at all involved with her emotionally or intellectually or physically. And now they are about to move to Laredo, Texas, where Sister Irene is from. And a lot of her family members are there. Her mother had, the Lord had used a dream in which her mother had told her in that dream to go back there and bring the rest of her family members into the kingdom. So Irene said that she had told this to Dan not long after they were legally married. And he agreed to go to Laredo. So take it away, Sister Irene.
So then the Lord started opening doors and closing doors so that we could prepare to come here. So I called my cousin and said, "Cuz, so the Lord is." I said, "We're coming to live in Laredo." He goes, "Oh, really?" He said, "Are you serious?" I said, "Yeah, I'm positive." He goes, "Okay." He said, "Well, when you get here, you come here and stay with me." So. Okay, so we prepared to
Okay, hold on. Can you tell me just, can you tell those at home a little bit about your cousin?
My cousin has been my cousin for, we go way back. He's, he was an ATF person for 25 years.
Agent.
He just retired.
You mean agent.
He just retired. And we just... amazing. He's an amazing individual, and he's got a beautiful home, and he keeps the whole family. He's the glue of the whole family. He holds everybody together.
Okay.
And his mom, my aunt, is she's not very doing very well. Well, she's doing fine. It just, she had a stroke and this her second one, but the family just loved him. They just welcomed him. They just loved him. And they never gave him, you know, they always respected him.
Uh-huh.
And we speak fluent Spanish, so when Dan was around, they spoke fluent English to him. They never gave him a hard time. They understood, you know, that when he was around and he didn't understand Spanish, and they never disrespected him, and they loved him, you know. Whatever,
uh-huh.
whatever he could do, you know, whatever they could do to please him, they did it.
Okay.
And I would tell Dan, I said, "Now look," I would ask, when Dan never wanted to associate with, after we got here a while, Dan, and we found our own apartment and everything, Dan got to where he didn't want to be around them. And
yes.
He didn't want to be around me. And he didn't know, he didn't want to be around us. I would ask him to go with me to see him. And his idea of socializing when he did go was, he was on the iPad. He never took his eyes off the iPad. And it was on the iPad or on the phone. Or he was, he never, ever spoke to my family. And we just, you know, we felt uncomfortable. I mean, I even felt uncomfortable. It got to the point where I didn't ask him to go no more to my aunt's house, because all he wanted to do was sit there on the iPad at the table or on the couch, or, you know, we thought we had done something wrong, you know?
Did he ever say why? Did he ever give a reason as to why?
Because he said the only excuse he kept saying was, "They're talking about me." Because they're speaking Spanish, that they're talking about him. And they were not talking about him because I was sitting right there the whole time.
Right.
It's a normal thing for us, for a person that speaks another language, to speak to each other.
Sure.
In
yes.
another language.
Yep.
Well, they thought, he said they were talking about him, and I said, "No, they weren't talking about you. They were talking about other things, other people. They were talking about things that they did through the week." And he called me a liar.
Wow.
Right out to my face, you're lying. You just don't want to tell me the truth. I said, "I'm telling you the truth." He
wow.
always called me a liar.
Okay,
always.
Hold on. Hold on right here. And this is while Dan, he's claiming to be a Christian. He's posting all sorts of things on Facebook. And he would probably tell other people, if they said, "Is your wife saved?" He would probably say yes to them, right? But he's called,
yes.
To your face, he's calling you these names.
Yes, it's true. I'm telling you the truth. He's called me a liar.
Yeah.
He's called me a liar. He's called me stupid. He's called me a dummy. He's called me, he's called me a wetback. He's called me all kinds of things.
Okay, now wait a minute. So he called you these names while you were married, while you were,
yes.
It wasn't, yes, during a fight. It was just, this was routine, right?
Yeah, it was routine. This is everyday, almost everyday life. If something didn't go his way, forget it.
Right. And as you had shared with me, even one time when he caused the alarm to go off because he opened the door earlier than either of you normally would in the morning to deactivate,
right,
the alarm, he blamed you for that, saying, mm-hmm, that you should have deactivated the alarm earlier. He blamed,
right,
that, even things that he did. Yeah. Okay. I wanted to make note of that. Okay. Go,
yeah,
ahead. So he didn't. Go ahead.
So then, every time something happened, it was my fault. Every time something happened, it was me, not him. He was perfect. He could do no wrong. But he never would admit when something would, if something would go wrong and it was his fault, he wouldn't say, oh, it's not my fault. It's your fault. It's your fault. Everything is my fault. I could do no right. I could say no right. I couldn't rewrite. I couldn't add right. I couldn't subtract right. I couldn't do anything right.
Right, and even when you were, the majority of the income to your family, or to you as a couple, was coming from you in your name, and,
mm-hmm,
yet he refused to allow you to see what he did with bills and bill paying. Do you want to just talk about that a minute?
Yeah, because I never got to see the check. I never got to see what went into the household because he wouldn't let me see it. I mean, it would come in, it would go into the bank. I never saw it.
Right. So you don't even know if he could have been enjoying pornography or something like that, for all you know, right?
Right.
Right.
I never, yeah.
We're not saying that he did, but that indeed is a possibility based on the number of hours that he spent on that computer, even into the wee hours of the morning. Like how late into the morning did he stay at the computer?
He didn't go to sleep till 3 o'clock in the morning.
Okay.
And I'm thinking, well, what's he doing up so late? Why didn't he go to sleep? You know?
And he didn't want to sleep in the same bed with you from the very beginning.
No,
we
haven't slept in the same bed for, I want to say, 4 years.
Okay.
You know? And I would ask him, and his excuse was, I snore too loud.
Right.
But he never wanted to go do anything. He never wanted to go take the test. He never wanted. I said, you want to go? Are you going to go take tests to see? And I was just wanting to see. But he didn't want to. He didn't. No, that costs money. No, that costs money. Well, if you would stop spending the money and put it on something useful like that.
Right. Right. And you had shared, too, that the things that he was spending it on were upgrades. You had mentioned that the TVs. He had to get a larger TV, et cetera.
Yeah. One day, last year, I got him, the Lord had put on my heart, he said, go ahead and get him a bigger TV, a little bit larger TV. So I said, okay. So I went, I told him, said, I'm getting you a little bit bigger TV. I got him a 55-inch TV,
okay,
for the living room. He got real excited. We went and got it. They brought it. They sent it to us. He put it up and the whole thing. Well, this year, it wasn't good enough. He wanted a 70-inch.
Right.
I said, and the day of that I was leaving, he texted me every I must have had 15 messages on my phone of where they had them on sale. 15 messages before,
wow,
I got home.
Wow.
Well, I thought, what is going on with this? And we kept going, beep, beep, you know, bleep, bleep, bleep.
Right.
I said, everybody kept saying, whose phone is that? Whose phone is that? I said, that's my phone. I'm sorry. And
right.
I wanted to turn it off, but I wanted to make sure I could hear it, something. You know, if my daughter would call or somebody would call me or something would come in and I needed to see about it.
Right.
You know, because I had a doctor's appointment that week and I needed to see, you know, what time they would need me, you know.
Right.
You know,
but you were spending a lot of days, you were the one that was going and doing things. Some of it was to help your aunt. But can you describe to me the feeling, the suffering that you went through at the thought of coming back to the house, what that was like, the extent to which...
Every time I started, I knew I had to go back to the house, to the apartment. I would start getting headaches, my stomach start hurting, I would start getting... I would start getting knots in my stomach. I would start, and I knew in my heart the Lord was going with me, and I knew He was there. I knew the Lord was with me, but it was like I was getting so. I would start getting real sick. My stomach would hurt. My head would hurt. My body would start aching. It was like I just wanted to just. I would. And when I would start getting in the car, I would say, Lord, I don't want to go. Please, Lord, don't let me go. Don't make me go home, Lord. Don't let me go. And I never called it home. I said, don't make me go back there, Lord. Yeah. Find me somewhere else to go, Lord. Find me. And I would start to weep. And the Lord said, I know. I said, I know. And I would hear the Lord say, I'm with you. I know, Lord. But it's torment, Lord. It's torment. Please, Lord. And then I'd get in the car. I'd turn it over. I'd turn on the car. Oh, Lord, I don't want to go, Lord. Please.
Yeah.
And I sit in the car, and the Lord, take deep breaths. I'm trying to calm down. I can feel my blood pressure rising. I said, Lord, I know, Lord, you're with me. I know. And I would take deep breaths until everything would calm down, and my stomach would stop being a nuts. But it would still be a nuts.
Yeah, and this was going on for months, right?
Months. Oh, yeah. Not months, years. I mean,
right.
For as long as I was with it, because I've been here 4 years, and my head's been up and down, and I'd say, Lord, it's just not fair, Lord, it's not fair. And the Lord said, take your eyes off of him and put them on me.
Praise the
and
Lord.
And that's the only thing that kept me going was putting my eyes on the Lord.
Yeah, he could somehow tell, or the devil inside Dan could tell when you were even reading the Bible in your bedroom, right?
Yes. Yeah, because every time I got where I would sit on the bed, and I would either reach for my phone or for my iPad, and I would open it up, and I would go to the scripture. I would read a scripture, I mean a chapter, and I would open it up to the Bible. It's like he knew. He would start coming into the door. You could bank it. If you could earn interest, take it to the bank and earn interest, he would open that door, and he would know. I would open that iPad up. I'd flip over the little flip it over,
yep.
And turn it on. And I would get to that. I would scroll to the scripture. There he come.
Yeah, amazing.
What are you doing? What are you doing?
And this man is posting things as though he is a Christian. I mean, most of his posts were, some of them were political, and I didn't, it's not like I even looked at his page that much, but they were, the majority of them had to do with the error in other people's doctrines. Ironically. So here he is purporting himself as a stalwart of truth. And in the real scene, in the real world, he is despising the fact that his wife is in the Word of God reading scripture.
And if I went and guessed what he said on Facebook about the Word of God, oh my goodness. Might as well shoot me.
Okay.
Just give him the gun and let him blow me away, because that's what he would do.
Right.
And if he'd asked me what I thought, I wouldn't have answered. Do not answer that question, because he would literally. You might as well give him a gun and let him blow me away, because that's right. What I deserved, to be blown away, according to him.
Right. Well, so going through all of this, you being a good Christian wife and a good, you know, a true daughter of the Lord. Were just your eyes were you he the Lord was telling you, just keep your eyes on me, but inside you were probably wondering, is this ever going to end?
There's times I thought that in my heart. I won't, because I don't lie. I said, Lord, when is this going to be over?
Okay.
But you know what I used to say too? I used to say, Lord, I'm here for the duration.
All right. Praise the Lord.
And I would say, Lord, I'm here for the duration, and I'm here, and I'm not leaving until you say so. And I'm not going to leave until you tell me to.
Okay.
And I'm not going to leave until you open the door and shut and weld this one.
Praise the Lord. Well,
and he did.
Now, let's take it from the point where, when did the Lord begin to speak to you about a deliverance? And can you tell us what happened?
When I was with my, one day I finally just got to the point where I couldn't take it anymore. And because Dan was really, one day I walked out of the bedroom. I was in the bedroom. Dad was in the living room. We had just gotten a brand new couch. Brand new couch.
Okay.
And I walked in. I was walking out of the living room, and I didn't have any clue. I have no idea what happened. I have no idea. Just that's what I've been trying to think of, what happened that day.
Okay.
Everything was fine. I don't know what happened. I cannot remember if something happened that day. But for some reason, Dan got so angry, he lifted the couch, that new couch, all the way from the bottom on the floor all the way to the top of his head and slammed it down to the floor.
Wow.
And I looked at him. The Lord said, don't move. I stood there. He said, slowly back away, back into the bedroom.
The Holy Spirit told you that.
Yes. The Holy Spirit said that.
Yeah.
And I slowly backed away and closed the door and sat back on the bed. I was going to the kitchen to go eat something to eat.
Okay.
I don't know what happened to. I just don't know what happened. That day is blank. I don't know what. I don't remember speaking. I don't remember anything. He did. I think he broke the leg on the couch.
Wow.
Because sometimes I would turn, it would turn. You know, a leg, when it turns, sometimes it won't stay there.
Yep. So you knew it wasn't stable, because a couch, usually it feels stable, like it's
right.
Part of the floor.
Then I'm thinking, I thought to myself, okay, because the way it happened, it was not called for, nothing was going on. And I'm thinking, I just sat there and stunned.
Right.
You know.
Wow.
And then he luckily, kind of like he let a roar out of him, I thought.
A roar? Okay. Did you say a roar?
A scream roar, like an anger. Okay.
Uh-huh.
Well, that's when the Lord said, say anything. And then I thought, okay. For some reason, I just felt like I had to let go, too. I let a roar out of me. But I did in my heart. You know how you sometimes you got to let go?
Uh-huh.
And I said to myself, Lord, what's going on? What is he doing to me? Why is he doing this to me? And that was the day the Lord said, this is when you start planning to go.
Wow. Okay, can you state the words again? Exactly what did the Lord say?
This is the day you start planning to go.
Okay. This is the day you start planning to go.
Yes.
Okay.
And I said, well, then you open my door, because I'm not going without you. That's what I said to him.
Uh-huh.
That's what I said to the Lord in my heart. And then as I sat there, and then I got up and I went back out the door, out the bedroom door. Dan said, I don't know why. He said, yeah. He said, you would probably leave and go stay with your girls. Just like that.
Huh. And he had no idea that the Lord had just spoken to you about leaving.
Yeah, and he said, and then I spoke up and said, and I finally said this. Why should I have to leave here? I can go live with my cousin.
Uh-huh.
And he didn't say another word.
Okay, tell me, how far away do your daughters live?
They live, they're in Louisiana. They live
Oh, so he was that. Could that have been his way of saying, let's head back in that direction? Or
no,
okay.
Not him.
Okay. Okay. Wow.
So I said, but why should I have to leave? I said, I got my family's here, my cousins are here. Why should I have to leave?
Right.
He didn't say another word.
Wow.
He just kind of like, whoop, he swallowed his words.
Okay. So then what happened?
That was it.
Okay.
And then after that, it's like he just got so angry. He was so bitter and so angry, like he wanted to kill. But he didn't speak to me. He didn't want nothing to do with me. He didn't. And I don't know what happened. Everything was fine.
So, okay, now are you talking about that day or from that point on? From that point?
From that point on.
Wow.
But he'd been angry with me and bitter with me before, the whole time. I'm not just talking about from this point on. I mean before that.
Yeah, oh, right. But did you notice a change in Dan's behavior, like the Lord was holding Dan?
Dealing with him. He was dealing with him.
Yeah.
Strong. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, he was dealing with him. And it's like the more he saw me, the more angry he got.
Wow.
The more he was dealing with it, his conviction, convicting him.
Yes.
The more he just, and I kept thinking, okay, you know, but I never spoke. And the Lord impressed on my heart to just be quiet.
Okay, yes. Uh-huh.
Be quiet. Don't add, don't speak, don't do anything. Just leave him alone. Totally alone.
Right.
And walk away from him like he doesn't even exist in your life.
Okay.
And I said, because you asked me the other day if there was any affection, if there was any hugging, I stopped kissing because he didn't brush his teeth. He didn't bathe. He didn't clean up. He didn't do anything like that.
Oh, wow.
His hygiene is horrendous.
So he didn't bathe or anything like that. You just started.
No, he didn't bathe. He bathed every other day, but you know how strong that odor gets and stuff. That's why I couldn't have nothing to do with it.
Okay.
And me, I'm an everyday. You bathe every day. You're supposed to. You know, you're supposed to clean up every day.
Uh huh. Yep. So did you start packing, or how did you go about that?
So the Lord spoke to my heart. He said, pack little boxes and put them in a closet. Stack them up where he can't see them.
Okay.
Because I had a closet and he had a closet.
Okay.
So I started packing the box little by little, and I would stack it in the corner where he couldn't see it and close the door. So when he was asleep at night, when he was asleep in the morning, before I went to go see my aunt, I would pack a little box and I would stack it in the corner. And I'd pack another little box and I'd slide it under the bed. And I'd pack another little box and I'd stack it over here. So until I was able to pack a little bit, you know.
Praise
that's
the Lord.
How I did it. That's how I did it.
Okay.
That's how the Lord impressed me to do things. But he never, ever knew it. And what I did with papers, my personal papers, I started taking them out where we had our papers. I started taking everything out. And he didn't even notice. And when I left, all of my papers were in the bag that looked like a regular bag. You know how you have a bag with just papers in them.
Right.
He didn't even notice that I had my papers.
Praise the Lord. So now, did you tell anybody when, once the Lord had told you that? Do you want to give a month, when this, the timeline? Because it's...
When the Lord finally told me about it, no, I didn't tell anybody at first.
Okay.
I prayed some more. I asked the Lord some more. I asked the Lord more. And finally, I talked to, I had a friend of mine, a girlfriend of mine.
Okay.
She lives in Louisiana, and I told her about it. She said, well, Sister Irene, it's what you have to do. You have to do what the Lord tells you to do.
Right.
She said, but make sure it's his timing. I said, of course.
Yeah.
That's what I'm waiting for, his timing.
Yeah.
So I had to tell somebody because I was going stir crazy, but I couldn't talk to anybody. I couldn't tell anybody because man was always there.
Oh, wow. Oh, wow.
I couldn't talk to anybody because every time I went to talk to somebody, he was listening to everything I was saying.
Oh, my goodness. So here you were keeping this. Oh, my goodness. That would be hard.
He was hovering on the door. He was hovering at the door. He was hovering right there. So I would wait until I would wait until he'd leave to go to the store, then I'd call them my friend or somebody to talk to.
Yes.
And it was hard. Oh, it was so hard to try to talk to somebody. Oh, my gosh. It was ridiculous.
Wow. Okay.
So I would say, Lord, please. And it was hard. And I would tell him, I can't call you because he's... Then I would call and say, okay, I can tell you now. I mean, I could call him. I could talk now because he's not here.
Right.
That's what I thought. And we would talk. I mean, that's the only time I had freedom. And then when I see him coming, I would see him on the camera because we had an alarm system and had cameras all over the place.
Right.
And I'd say, okay, I'm watching the camera. He's not here right now. And if I cut you off, it's because he's coming.
Yep.
He'd say, okay, that's the only way I could talk. That's how bad it was.
So you just kept packing, and you only had the opportunity to talk in a very limited way with anyone else. So you were really getting your instructions from the Lord, right? Looking to Him.
I was getting my instructions from the Lord, a little by little, step by step. And I was being quiet, and I was going to my aunt's, and I would come back, and I would be quiet, and it was hard because I had it all bottled up inside me. And when I finally got to tell my cousin, and he'd say, did you tell him? And they would ask me when I finally got to tell my family, they would ask me, did you tell him? I go, I'm not telling him anything. The Lord won't let me.
Right.
You know, and there was times I would go to say, what bills do we have? What is it to you? What is it to you? I'd say, okay. The only thing that Dad would talk to me about was food.
Wow.
He would print out a recipe. Wanted mommy to fix it. So he'd print the recipe out, I'd cook it. That was the gist of our conversation.
Yeah, and I do want to point out here how, you know, when the Lord's calling a man to lay his life down, to love his wife as Christ loved the church, is what they're commanded to do. That means that the wife, they become a servant to the wife. If you are married, to those at home, if you're married to a man that is considering you as though you come before him, your feelings come before his own. What you need comes before his own needs. Then you are really married. Then you have a real husband in the Lord's sight. But here we're looking at what Irene was living with, a man that was ordering her, that never did one thing for her. Couldn't even wait. Would not allow her to even have the ease of a shopping cart, which I certainly know what that's like, going to a grocery store. It helps. And here she's disabled. And this man, in his abject selfishness and completely abdicating any hint of being a husband, insisted in a totally selfish way what he wanted for his needs. And rather than putting her needs before his own, her needs did not exist. So here we're coming to the end of this thing. And you told your cousin, go ahead.
Sister, let me tell you this. A husband helps his wife when she's doing the housework, right? Helps move the furniture or helps, you know, vacuum and that. He never helped me do it. He's seen me doing it. And I would have to push and shove the furniture to get it out of the way so I could, you know, vacuum and mop and whatever. He never did that.
And that's incredible.
I had to huff and puff and move the furniture because he wouldn't do it.
And here you are disabled to boot.
Exactly. And I don't know how many times I almost hurt myself severely because he would not move the furniture. And I had to get instruments to help me to get under the furniture so I wouldn't have to move it.
Oh my goodness!
He would sit there on the iPad or on the computer watching me clean, and he would not move for 1 minute, for 1 second.
All the while posting Christian things on Facebook too. All the while presenting himself like he's the stalwart of Christian, posting all of these things while treating his wife in an absolutely wicked, wicked way. You were
and
a
he
wife.
Would do more. He would treat the birds, the baby, the birds. We have two birds. He would treat them with more love and compassion than he would treat me.
Yes. Well, let's get on to the deliverance. Tell me, because this is really exciting. Your cousin now, the ex-ATF agent, it retired.
Yes.
But all of your family, as you explained to me, most of them are in the law enforcement realm or worse. So they're highly respected, highly known. They do things well and kindly, but by the book. And now your deliverance is imminent. Can you tell us what happened in those last couple
of
weeks?
The day finally came when he said, we had been talking about it off and on, and he said, my cousin finally said to me, he said, cuz, he said, I had to decide it January the 1st I would get out.
Okay.
And this was about December the 8th of this last year.
2017.
And he said to me, he said, cuz, we're not waiting to January the 1st. You are getting out now. I said, because, he said, it's Christmas and my aunt. And he said, no. We're not waiting until January 1st. My mom is fine. Everything is fine. And you're getting out. And I don't want to hear no more about it. I said, what? He said, you're going to go get the bank straightened up, and you're going to take the Social Security, and you're going to, and he was going down the line telling me everything, and he said, and I don't want to hear no more about it. And I said, yes, sir. That's all I could answer was, yes, sir. We go do all this. We went through all this. Okay.
Yeah.
So yes, and I'll get the boxes, and you know where we're going to get the cousins, and we're going to do it. And I said, and yes, sir. I said, okay. I said, and we're going to catch him off guard, and we're going to, he sleeps late. He's going to be, and I mean, he had it all figured out. I said, okay. Don't you worry about a thing. He said, we got this. We got it. We got your back. You just do what I tell you.
Praise the Lord.
Well, come the time comes. First, it was going to be 3 o'clock. No. We're going to do it at 1 o'clock. He already had that secret, but we got, he said, you're not taking your car. You're taking the first picture of my truck. We're taking my truck. And all the cousins are following me. I said, say what? We got all the cousins, and you're going to call the police, and they're going to come. I said, what? He said, you heard me. You're going to do just what I tell you. Yes, sir. So,
praise
sure
the
enough,
Lord.
1 o'clock came along. We went. We got the cousins. We went. We got. There is a, when we drove into the apartment place, we called the police, and they didn't want to, first they weren't going to do it, and they said, I told them, he has a tendency to get violent. Oh, no, ma'am, don't you go near that place until we call somebody. Get somebody out there right now.
Well, yes, ma'am. And Dan had just shown,
sure.
He showed that violence with the couch.
Exactly. So he said, so sure enough, they said somebody, I mean, it was 5 minutes, they were right there on me. They were right there. And there was a lady that came up, and she said, ma'am, she said, I understand you need some backup. I said, yes, ma'am. She said, okay. And she knew my cousin, okay?
Uh-huh.
My cousin. So I said, okay. And then there was a tall police officer. My word, he was tall, 7 foot tall at least. So I looked at him and said, yes, ma'am, we got you. We got your back. So they followed David Woodburg, and then we followed behind them.
Wow.
We walked up. My cousin parked where he couldn't be seen. And then my cousins, they parked way up where they couldn't be seen. And then we walked up. The police officers walked first, and then I walked behind. They knocked at the door. Dan opens the door, and he looked up. He saw them, and she said, sir, she says, she wants to take her things, and she wants to get out. And then he looked at them. He kind of looked like a blank stare, like, uh-oh. And all he said was, well, she didn't have to bring the cops. And all I did was motion for him to go over there. He went over there and sat down on the couch. He grabs his iPad. Grabs the iPad and sits down.
Dan is. That is, yes. Dan. Yes. Okay.
Yes, Dan. And he sat down. My cousin, I guess, and then my cousin said he spoke to him. I don't know. I wasn't paying that close attention. I turned around and I hollered, okay, cousins, let's go. And they all came in, and we started packing.
Okay.
Fast. I mean, 45 minutes, sister. It was an amazing feeling of victory. I was shouting in my spirit, in my soul. I was shouting and praising God.
Praise
the Lord.
We
started packing. We were in a rhythm, sister, in a rhythm. God was, ooh, we were in a rhythm, rhythm, rhythm. We were go, 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 go. And I was putting in bags. We were putting in boxes. We were go, go, go. And wow. Before I knew it, sister, we were walking out of there.
Praise
we had everything
the
in the truck. They said, okay, everybody ready to go? We took off. And then he said, we're going to the bank. And we're going to clean it out. I said, what? He said, you heard me. You heard me. I said, yes, sir.
Yes, praise the Lord.
That's all I could say was, yes, sir. So we got it. We got here.
Okay.
We picked up something to eat. We got here. He said, now, he told me, he said, you're not going to the house. You're not going to my mom's house. You're going to stay for the weekend, and you're going to collect your thoughts.
Wow.
And I said, and then when he left, I wept like a baby. I said, thank you, Jesus, the peace of God all over me. Oh, sister,
praise
the victory
Jesus.
That I felt. Like nobody knows.
Praise you, Jesus.
That too, I can tell you. You know what? You can feel that victory. Listen to me, all of you that are in bondage. Feel like you cannot get out. God will make a way when there is no way.
Praise you, Jesus.
He will. He will for you. Trust me. Pray and seek Him with all your heart, mind, soul, and spirit. And He will make a way for you. You've got to trust Him and know Him. Seek Him with everything in you, and He will show you the way. Where there is no way. Oh, I praise Him because of who He is.
Praise
know
me.
Him that He will show you the way. Open your door. He will open your door. Close the ones that He does not want you to have. He won't give you an answer because you won't ask Him for an answer. He's a gentleman.
Yes.
He won't force you to leave a marriage.
But
yes. He won't leave. But He is a gentleman, and He will give you an answer. I know because I am a walking testimony right here where
Amen.
I am.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise you.
Praise you,
Him.
Jesus.
Praise Him for what He's done for me. I know. I know because I'm a child
Jesus.
Of the King.
Praise
and I thank you,
Lord.
Sister, for having me on your program.
Well, I just thank the Lord. And Lord, I ask you to speak to each one that will listen to this testimony,
thank
Lord.
Jesus.
And if they don't know you, that they will right now reach out to you because you've come to set the captives free. And all of these marriages that are no marriages, there are many more husbands like Dan. And I call right now, I call them before you, Lord, and I ask those wives to seek you with their whole heart, that they will receive the Holy Spirit and then listen for your instructions to them because you have called them to peace. And also those husbands that can be in similar bondage, that you will cause those husbands to seek you and listen to your instructions just as Irene did for the timing, for everything. Lord, you are a God. When you deliver in a big way. And we praise you for your faithfulness. Praise you for what you're going to do to each one. In Jesus' name. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. Thank you for joining us today. Thank you to Sister Irene. And I plan to have her on for another segment in the midst of her deliverance. As the Lord will, you know, He is faithful to many times give us revelation as to what we were in when we didn't even know. And Irene found out that there was more that she was living with than she could ever have imagined that came out.
Indeed.
But the Lord wants us free more than we want us free. Amen?
We can't do God's work if we're in bondage.
Amen. No, this is too late in time. He wants those that are love Him and that are following Him. He's called us to do things for Him.
And time is too short to be in bondage.
Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you. Thank you, Sister Irene, and thank you all for listening. And stay tuned to the next conversation with Sister Irene. God bless you.
And thank you, Sister. God bless you.
Okay. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye.